Hey guys, welcome back to the shop. So we have a little modification job to do right here on these two wheel hubs. This is a sample that he had sent for me to just to kind of play around with and make sure it was going to work right. And that's exactly what I've done. So on these two guys right here, these are for Mustangs, or you know, Mustang front ends. And what they needed to do is to take the shoulder length right here, bring it down so that it's got a total length of 0.688. You might consider that a depth right there, 0.688. So we got to take right at 100 thousandths off of these faces right there to lower what they call the centering lip on these hubs right there. And he's got this stuff kind of, he's got some silicone and some cardboard and tape in there just to keep chips out of the bearings. And he got it taped up on the back there. So I would prefer to chuck this without the tape on there, but it ain't gonna make a difference, I don't think. We're still gonna use copper soft jaws to chuck that because it's got that gear on there. And you can see on this guy what I'm talking about. So this one was just a sample hub for me to try out, which is what I did. I did this just a minute ago. Took a couple of videos to share over on the Instagram and the Facebook page. So maybe I'll throw that in the video right now so you can see this guy. And then we'll go over there to the lathe and go ahead and get these other two guys done. We're going for a 688 hub length here. And what I'm using for my measurement tool today, this is one of my old school Starrett number 445 depth mic. So it's just got one of the sides removed from it. Makes it a little bit easier and a little bit more balanced whenever you want to hang it off of an edge like this right here, which is what I'm doing. And just hold it down with one hand and then come down there with your other hand and get your measurement. And I have that one at 0.688 right there, which is what he had on the spec. And he even provided a print right here so that we could see that. And if I zoom in to this right here, you can see exactly what it is that he's asking to do. So right now it's at 0.787, 20 millimeter, bring it down to 0.688, 17 and a half millimeter. And a pretty simple job right there. So we'll go over to the lathe, use a four jaw chuck, get it indicated running true, cut 100 thousandths off of it, chamfer it, and that's all there is to it. I still have the jaw set from the sample piece that we did. So they should be right on this diameter here, which is about 4 inches, by the way. So just start by trying to get the face of that flush with the face of the jaw there, just kind of get it squared up to minimize how many bumps you're having to take with indicating it. And then we just come down and don't bite in real hard. You just want enough just to hold it right there, right? Just to hold it. We'll come back up to this guy, make sure it doesn't fall out. Take one of our copper pieces of copper pipe, which is our soft jaws, sandwich between the jaw and the gear. Go ahead and give it a little snug there, and I go ahead and go 180 out. Just make sure it doesn't fall out on you. All right, those two have it nicely. Now we can come to this side and do the same thing. All right. Let's see how bad we are. Yeah, we got some wobble to it. That'll be all right. We'll go ahead and start with our face. Get our dial indicator set up on the face right here. Just like that. Oh yeah, so got about 80 thousandths. Let me reposition you so you can see this a little better. I can get in there, and what we'll use is our soft blow hammer right here to bump it around. All right, so what I'm gonna do is watch for the highs. Right there, that's the high, that's the low. So I don't care where it's at on this dial, I'm just looking for the high, okay? I'm gonna come around here to this side and we wanna just kinda bump it. We're gonna just keep working the high. High, just keep working the high until you get it. Look at that, that's within a couple thousandths right there. It's within a thousandths. Got a little bit of movement right on the face there. So I believe these have been used. They've already had wheel studs installed and they've been mounted up with wheels and everything. So these faces aren't gonna be completely straight from machining because they've already been pulled on. But just get it averaged out. And I'm just watching this dial right here. You go one jaw, flip it around 180 and see where it's at and compare the reading. So that one right there is within a half a thousandths. Let's see, that one, that one's about maybe a thousandth. So let's see if we can, see, I went too far with it right there. That's pretty good. So what we're gonna do from here, we'll go ahead and reposition our indicator and let's just fuzz on there like from a rag or something. We'll get it right up here on this part of the hub. All right. And then we'll get our run out that way. Well, let me move you so you can see that a little better. Okay, there we go. And if you want to, you can move this around using the fine adjust on the bottom on our Noga. So always start with your highs and tighten it first because you're not fully tight yet. So just start snugging the highs. Look at that. Within 2,000ths right off the bat, but it's not tight enough yet. So what we got to do is go around to all four of them, make sure that they're snug so that when you start cutting it, it's not going to try to move it or pull it out. And then you go back to your indicating. So there's your high. And since we've got our copper plus all this tape on here, you can put a little bit of squeeze on that without worrying about it. So we're just gonna move our high since we're that close. It's got like a little low spot in there on that hub. And all you wanna do is just average it out. All right, so that's indicated right there. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna move the indicator back to the face, make sure this hasn't moved out any. If it is, I gotta bump it around. We'll have to repeat these two processes again to make sure that it's concentric and running nice and straight and true. All right, that's exactly what's happened on this. It's moved a little bit there. So I need to bump this around. We're about 5,000ths out. Let's see if we can safely move it without moving it too far. Got about a thousandths. That one's good. It's these two right here that are out just a little bit. And this is plenty close enough. You're talking about a thousandth of an inch on this face right here. I'm trying to get it in because that's just how my mind works, is get it as close as we can. But since it's not wanting to move, all right, there we go. It's got that low spot. in between, but this is the same this way. Go back to this one. It's within a thousandth, so we're there. So I'm going to come back to this journal, make sure that we're centered up on our jaws, get that indicated, and we'll bring you back and we'll go ahead and get that faced off. All right, so I've already measured it. We got exactly 100 thousandths to take off of this. So we're just going to go ahead and we'll get our tool touched off. And come on. I want to zero the DRO, and I've got my little, clamp over here that holds a dial indicator. This is one of the Edge Technology carriage clamp. It's what this guy is. And I just find that I'm so used to looking down here at a dial indicator. Let me show you what I'm talking about here. When I'm running my lathes, I'm so used to just looking down here for doing things like this. I love my DRO, so don't think that I'm talking negatively about having the DRO and using it, but I just like having both things for reference, just like I like having my dials here for reference too. So we got that set to zero, so I can just real easily look down here and I can see the machine running, I can see my movements and everything, and I can see this moving. When you're up here and you're watching this, it's like your eyes are up here instead of looking down here on the machine. So just point something out there that I like to do. So, you know, we'll move this in 20 thousandths, and it's beeping at us because we've gone past our zero point right there. All right, so let's go ahead and get some cuts made on this. We'll just do 25, this is 50. That insert's a CNMG 431, by the way, using my Walter tool. Great tool for using it in this position or using it for chamfering. I'm gonna go ahead and take another 25, so it's gonna be 75. And that should leave me with approximately 25. So what we'll do from there is go ahead and stop it. We'll get our mic over here and see if we can do some measuring on it to verify how much we got left to take. And I'm making sure that I'm not in that radius there on that shoulder. So kind of hang it out a little bit. You can kind of rock it a little bit, hear the squeak like you would on an OD mic. Do that again because I moved it. All right, so I'll do my back math there and see what we got left to take. All right, according to the micrometer, we've got 26 thousandths. So I'm gonna just use my dial right here. 26, and that equaled 100 thousandths on the DRO, if you wanna include the 4/10, about 100.5 thousandths right there. All right, let's make this final cut. Now we can use this tool here to go ahead and put a chamfer on this side. And now what I gotta do, I'm gonna turn the lathe off so I don't get up here next to it. We can use a little bit of this insert to chamfer that inside, but you gotta pick it up, otherwise it'll rub the bottom side of the insert. So we just pick it up a little bit like that. Come in here just ever so gently. Pull it back. Just like that right there. All right, so I want to take my gray Scotch-Brite, make sure that there's no sharp edge on this, but that feels good. But we want to soften it up, so just fold it up some here. Just kind of soften up that edge that you just cut on it. So, now we'll go ahead and measure it again. And we're good. So it's about, according to this mic, it's about 0.5 thousandths off right there. Not a big deal. 0.5 thousandths. Let's do it again. that time it's dead on at 0.688. So well within a tolerance that we need to be for the job at hand right there. So that's one down. We got one more to do. I'll probably put the other camera in there and just get you some close-ups maybe of the tool cutting and repeat what we just did here. $75,000. We'll go ahead and mic it now and take our final cut. Let's see where we finished it out at. Looks like 0.688 and maybe 2 to 3 tenths. So can you guys see that? Right where we need to be. All right, our second hub is done. Get that in neutral there. Just show you how I usually take them out and just bring it down to where it just touches. That way it holds it in there. Doesn't allow it to fall out. While you get the copper out of here. If you're coming back in with the same thing like what I've been doing, you bring it back down so that your jaw is set to that diameter again. Not important here because we're done now. So go ahead and take it out, and you can see where the copper has pushed the tape there, but there should be absolutely no damage to those teeth on this gear there at all. The copper is softer than this piece that's on there. All right, so there we go. There's a little job finished up for Optimum Performance Racing. I think it's Optimum Mustang is what it's called. But anyway, just a quick little job, pretty simple to get done. Thought I would share it with you guys. I'm sitting here kind of waiting around on the electrician. They're supposed to come by and look at a couple jobs for me. So I wanted to go ahead and get this knocked out this morning early, get it done. I'll go ahead and get this boxed up, everything wrapped up, boxed up, and sent back to them. So fun little job shop thing there to do with some indicating, some measuring and stuff like that. I know a lot of people watching still enjoy seeing this kind of stuff. So any chance we get, we're going to put this on the channel there. So hopefully you enjoyed this little project. So I think what I'd like to do here is give you guys some kind of updated shop tour, show you some of the things that I've been working on. I've been getting the office area set up there so that I can actually have a desk and a place to sit down with my computer, do some video editing, and anytime I need to sit down to do some other kind of work there. So we'll take you in the office area there and show you what's going on with that. I also wanted to talk about some of the developments out here in the shop. You know, some installs that we're going to be working on here very soon, and some other things like that. So let's just walk you around and show you what's going on right now and some of the things that we currently have that's about to get started here in the shop. All right, so I'll begin right here with the Flex CNC. So this guy is getting ready to be set up here very soon. I'm currently filming this on a Saturday, and they're going to be here on the following Monday to start beginning the setup process here. So a couple of the guys from Flex, I believe it's Chris and Andrew, they're gonna be coming down here, and they'll be here for at least 2 days. I think they've got Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday scheduled to be here and start beginning the installation process of the Flex CNC. So what that's gonna entail is that the guys have to come in and get the machine bolted together properly. They have to mark the locations on the floor here where we want to get it drilled to be lagged down. It's going to be squared up a little bit too. That's kind of sitting at an angle. So we'll get it positioned exactly where I want it. They're going to end up marking the hole pattern there in the floor. And how this goes is that there are, I believe it's right here, yeah, leveling pads in this box right there. So I believe what they do, mark the hole locations, and then once the hole locations are marked, you actually have to move the machine out of the way and drill the holes, mount the leveling pads down to the floor, get them lagged down, and then the feet actually are setting on the leveling pads, and that's how they level it out. So that's kind of the process of getting it set up where it needs to be. They get it leveled and set up, operational, and then after all that's done, the machine is actually set up, ready to go. The next process is where you come in and actually machine the rails on the machine. They always machine these after it's set up, after it's level, and then all the rails are machined. They just take a few thousandths off to clean it up. And Aaron from Flex, he'll be coming down the following week to help me do that, do some more training on the Flex, and kind of kickstart that process of getting the machine machined, the rails, and ready to go. So this is sort of a big job that's going to get ready to start real soon. I do plan on shooting some video of the install. I know Flex wants a little bit of video of the install as well, so that they can share on their social media channels as well. So this will be coming up in the coming weeks. I'm not sure when, but a couple weeks we'll probably have this guy ready to share with you on the channel, of at least getting it set up and maybe the first test cuts on it, things like that. All right. So I wanted to update you on that right there. Now I also want to point this out. I've got some more machinery back here that is not set up yet. I don't want to go into detail with this yet, but these are a couple new machines from Hymer. One is the Uno Smart. This is going to be your presetter. Your presetting machine right there. And then we have the Hymer power clamp back there, which is going to be used for heat shrinking of tools. All right. And once I think it's going to be in a couple weeks, we're going to actually have a technician from Hymer come down and get these guys all set up and operational too. The other thing is that I've got my electrician. He is coming next week to work on getting the power run from that. That's a transformer up there that's going to convert it to, I think it's 480 voltage to run the Flex CNC. It's also going to be used for the Hymer power clamp, because that runs off of 480 there as well. So electricians come in and get those hooked up. I'm going to bring you back and we're going to go into more detail on the Hymer machines. Really excited to learn how to use those. And once those are ready to go and I actually know how to operate them, I'd like to show you a dedicated video on those machines right there and how we'll be able to use those for our tools, for our CNC machines. All right. So I think that was the update here. We've been using our Miltronics TRM3016. I've been using that for the fixture plates. So nothing new to share with you here yet there. We've got our new Kaser air tower hooked up. I believe I've already shown you that. All right. So another new thing we're getting ready to do behind the pacemaker here. We'll talk about this here in a minute, but come back here to this area. And I want to show you this new mixing unit that we're getting ready to install. So this is the HydraBlend 6160 wall mount right here. And I've been working with Master Fluids, and they are providing this mixing unit right here, as well as some of their Trim Microsol 685. This will be your soluble oil. My plan is to get this guy hooked up. We're going to mount it on the wall right here in this area above the sink. We'll get the HydraBlend mounted here, and then I'm going to get a RealCraft hose reel, and we'll mount it either next to it or above it right here on the wall. That'll be plumbed in to the HydraBlend mixing unit. This is supposed to be a pretty sweet setup, and I'm actually really excited to get this going, because this is going to eliminate my old school method of walking outside with a little bit of soluble oil in a bucket, filling it up with a water hose, bringing it inside and dumping it in a machine. That's what a lot of us guys have done over the years, old school machine shops, you know, that's how it works. This right here is gonna eliminate the need to do that. And how it works is that you you tie in your water supply, either a garden hose, or you can just plumb it directly into your water supply. What I plan to do is tap into the cold water line down there for that faucet and have a line that comes up and hooks in right there. And then on your discharge where the mixing chamber is here, you'll have, this is where you would actually have another hose that comes out to your machine. In my case, I'm gonna have this going to a RealCraft hose reel. It'll be probably about like that guy right there, mounted up on the wall. And what that allowed me to do is this will siphon right here directly from the 5 gallon pail. So it'll siphon the 685, have the water coming in. It's gonna mix it to the proper ratio that you set right here. When we first start, we'll go at either like somewhere between 8 and 10%. So you adjust this little valve and mix it. You'll be able to pull the hose from the RealCraft reel out directly to the machine that you want to fill up the coolant. So there's no carrying buckets, super easy. And then when you're done, you just simply shut it off, or you have a ball valve on the end of the hose that'll be on the hose reel, and because it just runs off of the water pressure from the tap. All right, so we're gonna have more on this. I'll show you guys this setup once we have it all set up, and of course how it's used, because I have to learn this process as well. It's supposed to be pretty simple though, once you get it hooked up and be able to mix your coolant properly. So really excited about that. We got a refractometer as well, so that we can use to check our coolant levels in the machine and make sure that we have the proper like 8-10% whenever we first install or first put the coolant, the fresh new coolant in the machines. So Justin over at Master Fluids, he's the one that's been working with me on this stuff right there. Got to meet all those folks at IMTS, and Justin actually came by and met me one day, talked to me, and they're excited to work with me and have me try out this this soluble oil there for the machine coolant. All right, so more on that later. We'll have a dedicated video for that install and getting all that set up and working. All right, nothing else new going on right here besides our Tico machine vise right there and our new stud hold down kit. And I think what I'd like to do, let's come over here. I'm gonna show you what I'm currently working on, and then we'll go into the office and show you what's going on down inside there. So we've got the compound for the American pacemaker here, and I've been trying to get going on this. But what I have done is, you probably have seen it now, I think I've already released the video anyway, machining this fireball tool fixture plate. And as I said in the previous video, I wanted to use it for this right here, do a little bit of practice. I've got my Biax power scrapers out, and I've been practicing a crosshatch pattern that I plan on putting on these two surfaces right here for the American pacemaker compound. I'm not planning on doing a full scrape and rebuild to match these two pieces together. That's not what I'm going for. We're going to be doing a simple crosshatch pattern on this to provide more points of contact and a place for it to oil and lubricate. That's how this was made 80 years ago whenever they made this compound, even though it's really hard to see. But there are flake marks in here, which is what I want to put back in there. We just got a little bit of wear on there. So we're gonna get this cleaned up. I wanna do a crosshatch pattern on that to provide a little bit of better oil retention for this, for our sliding movement. So these are a couple scrapers that I had purchased from a gentleman, I believe it was last year. I can't remember if it was last year or maybe the year before that. I don't remember now, but he was a retired employee from GM. And somebody put me in contact with him because he had these tools and he didn't know what to do with them. He didn't think anybody wanted this stuff. I was put in touch with this gentleman, and he told me what he wanted for him, and I thought it was an excellent deal. So I bought his power scraper and his power flaker. They both came included with all of the tips, you know, the carbide tips that you use for the scrapers there. So I think it was really cool that he had all this stuff. This is the ones for the flaker right here. So, you know, it's just got, it's got history to it. You can smell the oil and all this stuff, and there's no telling how many machines he worked on at GM with his scrapers there. And that's what these guys are right there. So it feels good having these guys, and that they were well used by a GM employee that did power scraping to rebuild machinery for General Motors. So anyway, trying to get a little bit of practice session in right here. Probably going to flip this around and do three more lines. Just try to get my pattern down so that I can apply it to the compound right there. So that's what I've been working on right now. And then I got to get all this cleaned up because in 2 days, Flex will be here getting this machine set up. So I got to kind of move all this stuff again because they have to move the machine around to do the drilling. So I got to, after this video and get this editing done, I got to get all this cleaned up and moved around ready for the Flex guys. All right, so I'm going to take you into the office. I'd like to show you what I've been doing in there. It's I've been making a few posts on Instagram and Facebook, showing the folks that follow me there a little bit of updates on that. As I said on the post, that kind of stuff is probably boring to a lot of people, but it is exciting for me to see the progress that I've been making in here and getting this done. I've been putting off getting a desk in here for all year long, actually. And I finally got one in here. I got a workstation that I can finally do some video editing. I believe the video that you're watching right here is the very first video that I've edited in the new shop right here. All my other editing I do at the house. I got a little office there that I do everything. So let's come in here and check this out. Hopefully the lighting is okay because it is a little dark in here, but I think it's turning out pretty good. So there we go. There is the new desk and the new workstation. And this is exactly how I had planned on laying this out whenever I moved into this. You got this sort of like cubby area. So I wanted to get an L-shaped desk and then have, you know, like a bookshelf, maybe a filing cabinet or something back there. And this is working out pretty good. Now it's not complete yet. I actually just hooked this up today and I'm waiting on the power strip that I ordered to be able to hook all this up. So I just got everything kind of jumbled up right here. Once that power strip comes in, we'll get that hooked up. I'll be able to hook everything in and have everything all tidy and neat the way it's supposed to be. But the other day, I had me and Abby went over there to McAllier's, which is in town that does office furniture and equipment and stuff like that. This was a desk that they keep in stock in like three or four different colors. It was the perfect size. It was affordable. It wasn't overpriced, you know. It's just an inexpensive desk. It's not real wood or anything like that, or hardwood, should I say. It's a laminate. So anyway, I picked this out. They came and delivered it the next day. And so this is like the new workstation right here. I got a window and a door I can look out when I'm sitting here. You see people come through the gate right there, but I'm really excited about this. So this is the video that you guys are probably watching right here that I'm editing. I got my MacBook set up. This is a monitor I had at the house that I used for my old computer. So I brought it down here and got a few more things on order. Got me a lamp, you know, just different things that I'm going to be getting set up right here to use as my my new workstation. Bought me a new chair. This is one of the Shaquille O'Neal chairs. So it's bigger. It's made for bigger people. Super comfortable. Got that at Office Depot and got that all set up. So when I ordered the desk, they offer bookshelves to match. So I got me a bookshelf. And then so you can see my Gerstner tool chest is setting here. I don't plan on leaving it here permanently, but I had this in the office because I don't have a place out in the shop area to keep it right now. So I decided to just put it right here for now until I get my Gerstner is working with me on a the roll around chest that these guys will sit on, and I'm waiting on them to actually produce those. They're going to make a production run, and when they do, they're going to let me know, and I'm going to be purchasing one of those roll around units that Gerstner chest is going to sit on. Really exciting for me because I've always dreamed of having the full Gerstner three-piece tool chest, the roll-around tool chest, and I'm going to have that eventually. So that's why one of the drawers is missing right here, because Scott Campbell had emailed me and said, send us one of the drawers out of this tool chest, and what they're going to do is they're going to try to color match it the best they can with this aged box with the new one that they're going to be making for this to sit on. So that's why the drawer's missing right there. So got a place for my books and things. The desk has a couple drawers that you can put files in. So really excited about that, having our little workstation set up right there. And so I'll pan you around here to the other side. Now the rest of the office isn't really finished out yet, but I have been working on this little area here. And on Instagram, Rob was like, asking about, like, hey, where's your coffee pot? So I got a coffee pot, we got a microwave, we got a little refrigerator. Abby's parents gave that to me as a gift a while back, so we, you know, we can keep our food in there. I got some snacks right here. But I don't think this is going to be a permanent setup, because I have an idea for filling out this office a little bit more in the near future. I've got a table over here that I've just been setting things on. So this is some of my new Walter tooling that I've got in for the CNC machines. I haven't really got to it yet, so just kind of sitting here. We've got different face mills, end mills, turning tools, inserts, parting blade, all stuff for the new CNC machines. I just don't have a place for this yet. And that is just some old work pants that I've been selling on Marketplace. So that's what that stuff is there. But the other big plans for the office right here is going to be a new stair granite surface plate that's going to be going in here. Really excited that it's going to be towards the end of the year or possibly January, whenever that's ready for delivery. So the other idea for the office is going to be a tool room or an inspection room. So not only my desk where I can work here, we're going to have our granite plate, be able to do our inspections in here. Now, on this side of the office, that area, what I would like to do is get with a local cabinet company and see about having some kind of like a kitchen cabinet system or counter along this wall right here with storage, and then be able to have an actual, you know, workbench along this wall that will be used with our granite plate that's going to be sitting in the middle of the office right here. Possibly a shelf or something along the top where we can put, you know, store tools up there. So that's the idea I have for that side. I got to find somebody in town that can help me figure this out and handle the install and everything. And then whenever I come out, have them quote that, I might see about having them do this side as well. That way it'll eliminate the tables and actually have a countertop there that we can set our, you know, kitchen stuff on and have storage underneath it for, you know, things like that. So that's kind of my idea for this area of the office. So like I said, it's probably boring stuff to a lot of people, but it's really exciting for me to kind of continue working on this idea and filling this space out to be able to have a nice functioning shop here that we can work out of. Oh, there was one more detail back here that I was gonna mention too. So I've actually got two of the Hewitt tool carts on order to be able to hold all of our tooling. So I've got one that's gonna be sitting like right here. It's more of a, I think they call it a workstation. It's got a wooden top and it's got a cabinet that you open up and you'll be able to put all of your tooling in there. It's got a drawer so you can organize a small tooling like inserts. And that's the plan for, it'll sit right here and that'll work for the Miltronic CNC. Right now I've just got a lot of tooling right here in this toolbox. So all these are gonna come out. It'll go in the Hewitt sitting right there. This is all of our Heimer 40 taper tooling, collet chucks and mill holders, shrink fit holders and things like that, collet. So, you know, I'm really excited to be able to get some proper organization for the collets. We got a lot of different size collets. We'll have multiple collets, and I want to get all that stuff organized in the Hewitt workstation here once we get that. It's supposed to be ready in a couple weeks. I ordered those suckers like, I don't know, 6 weeks ago. So I guess they're having to... some of those things they have to manufacture to order. You know, they don't necessarily have that stuff in stock ready to go. We've also got one of their, I believe it's called the Tool Scoot. You know, it's one of the tool carts. And that's going to be for the 50 taper tooling for the Flex CNC. So that'll be delivered as well. And we'll probably be able to, you can see back here, these are all the 50 taper tools right here, all the Heimer tooling. I'll have a little bit of space back here so that Hewitt tool scoot, it may just end up sitting back here somewhere holding all the tools that we're not currently using whenever we're not running the running the Flex CNC. So that was a couple more updates that I wanted to talk about. And once we get those guys in and get them set up, I'll be sure to share those with you as well. And I think that kind of covers all of the current updates that I wanted to share with all you guys that enjoy watching these videos and seeing this whole new shop area get filled out and ready to go. So there's always kind of something in the plan, something in the works, plenty of things to do around here. And I think that's going to be it for this shop update. I hope you guys enjoyed, and we will see you on the next video. Scratched it right there. I'm turning that thing at an angle and I don't realize I'm doing it. That's better right there. This is why I'm practicing, because it's been a little while since I've done it, and I got to get the motion back down again. I actually like it more comfortable when I'm going from the left to the right. When I go from right to left, just not as comfortable doing it. I just wanted to kind of give you guys a little shot of what it is that I was trying to do right there. Just working on a simple crosshatch pattern. And once I get comfortable with it, what I've been doing is I've been making a pass across this. I take the fixture over to the Miltronics and I just deck a few thousandths off of it to clean off the scrape marks, and then do it again. Just keep practicing it. So I'll probably keep working on this today for a little bit and kind of get ready so that we can apply this pattern over there to our American pacemaker compound.